It's my 47th birthday, and I'm standing over the sun-hardened carcass of a camel in an area outside Gus in northern Kenya. The mighty camel, which has always represented for me the last bastion of the desert, the last one standing, decomposing at my feet, unable to withstand a drought that has ravaged this region for the last 3 years. Antut tells us that she used to have over 100 animals, and that the last few camels have recently died. We beg family and friends, she tells us, but no one can help. The reservoir, which once supplied water for all the surrounding communities, lies arid and empty under the Kenyan sun. Chief Mariam Lengure tells us that it has been dry for 3 years now. The only water available now is from boreholes, she says, but that water is salty.
Today we met a mother who had to bury her newborn. It was maybe only 10 days old child. So she took us around behind where she lived to her now unused goat pen. And in the front corner, there was a tiny fresh mound of sand where she had buried her child. And on top, there was an IV bag with the tubing. And I asked her why it was there. And she told me that it was the last thing that was attached to her baby before she buried her child. And she'd left it there as a sort of marker or a memory, I guess. And it was a very profound thing to see.
A desolate place on a rocky plateau where the road literally comes to an end. Here we find a small, ragged settlement of displaced families from the Turkana tribe. Aliwo is boiling some berries over a small fire. They are poisonous, she tells us. I have to boil them 10 times to make them safe to eat. The salty water makes it difficult to boil, but it's all we have. It's clear to me that women are the ones holding everything together here, carrying the greatest burden of responsibility with all the odds stacked against them, and having to live with decisions that no parent should ever have to make. Girls as young as 10 are being given away as brides to men as old as 60, in exchange for a dowry that is desperately needed to buy food for that girl's starving siblings.
Today we met the chair lady of this particular community. She's called Injitro Aloto. This community has moved down here simply to be closer to the nearest town because they heard that they might be able to get help here. But sometimes it's literally 1 kilogram of food to try and feed as many people as possible, which is nothing. They're also getting cash transfers from Concern Worldwide, which helps them to buy food. And obviously the price of food has soared recently. And she said, if you are able to get any help, please don't forget us, because we desperately need it here.
Across a dusty plain, we meet Koronto, who invites us in and explains that she used to have 150 goats, the majority of which have died. Koronto holds up 2 bowls, revealing no more than 2 cups worth of maize kernels and ground flour. This is what I have to feed my 7 children, she says softly. When we don't have food, we just sleep. As we leave, she thanks us for coming. May your family be blessed, she says. The Horn of Africa is responsible for less than 1% of the emissions that accelerate climate change. Yet the people here are the first to feel the unforgiving wrath of its effects. Now if Koronto, who has almost nothing left but life itself, can find the strength to bless us, then surely, we must find it within ourselves to return that blessing.